My castaway this week is a lyricist, Jesus Christ Superstar, Don't Cry For Me, Argentina, I Know Him So Well. They're some of the most famous and popular songs ever written for the musical theatre. His work with Andrew Lloyd Webber transformed the British musical, so it's startling to note that they produced only three shows together. After the split, his career as a lyricist fell away for a while, but re-emerged splendidly a decade ago as the author of the books for the award-winning Disney films Aladdin, Beauty and the Beast and The Lion King, the latter written with Elton John. In between all this songwriting, he's found time to run a record label, found a publishing house, and watch and play a lot of cricket. As he's happy to confess, he's never allowed his working career to dominate his life. He is Sir Tim Rice. The problem, of course, Tim, being a lyricist, is everybody thinks it's easy, because if the lyrics are effective, they're kind of simple. You can latch on quickly and you can think, I could have done that.
Well, I think everybody can write lyrics, because most people can read and most people can write. But it's a question, really, of can everybody do it well? I think composers are slightly fortunate in that they have a kind of mystique, because not everybody can write music. But it's very hard for a prodigy to turn out great literature until he or she is 17 or 18. It's very rare that anybody writes anything other than a sort of curiosity,
what
like
about
the young visitors. But composers, because composition is abstract and lyrics are much more definite, then it's possible for a composer to hit the jackpot really very young.
But can you define, then, what it takes to be a good lyricist? Is it possible to define it?
I think I'm quite good at getting a situation into song, into lyrics. But that's because I can imagine a character. I can imagine a lady on a balcony talking to 20,000 workers at a demonstration, and I can write a song about that. Or I can imagine a warthog with wind problems. These are things which you have a real character, and you can therefore write something that works for that character.
But does it help as well if it's something that you feel yourself? I mean, if it's written from the heart, as it were.
I think that helps. I don't think it's essential. I mean, I've written several songs which I do not believe in what the character's saying, and that's obviously going to happen, because in most musicals you're going to have opposite points of view. You're going to have characters at odds with each other. I certainly think my favourite lyrics of the ones I've written would probably be ones that I actually agree with. But then most
like
of them,
which?
I don't know, having asked me that. I mean, I was about to say that most of my most successful ones seem to have been written from the point of view of women. And I obviously haven't been in exactly those situations. I mean,
but
I don't know how to love him.
I Know Him So Well, of course.
Yes, that was a situation which I had been involved in real life, watching it from the sides, as it were. So I think a lot of it, I mean, Chess, the musical Chess from which that song comes, was the only one really written around a lot of experiences I'd had. I mean, obviously Jesus Christ Superstar wasn't, and neither was Evita. But there were certainly great tracts of Evita which I agreed with what the characters were saying, and there were great tracts when I violently disagree with what
but
the characters
But what is brilliant is that the public suddenly will elevate something that maybe you didn't see coming, and Don't Cry For Me, Argentina is the most extraordinarily unusual line. You can't have said, here's a really catchy line, this is going to get them between the eyes.
No, well, it was written not as a pop song. I mean, a lot of people have said, oh gosh, that song is just a string of clichés. Well, that's exactly what it's meant to be. It was written as a scene in a show with this dishonest woman addressing a public, like many politicians do, and not really saying anything. And we were rather surprised. And in a way, we thought, well, this has really almost been too successful, because just as Eva Perón fooled a lot of people into the fact that she was saying great things, so this song has kind of fooled people into thinking it's a great song. Having said that, very arrogantly, I think it is a great song, but I'm not quite sure why. It's got a great tune, perhaps.
I want to tell the people of Argentina, I've decided I should decline all the honors and titles you've pressed me to take, for I'm contented. Let me simply go on as the woman who brings her people to the heart of Beirón. Don't cry for me, Argentina. the truth is, I shall not leave you, though it may get harder for you to see me. I'm Argentina, and always will be. Have I said too much? There's nothing more I can think of to say to you. But all you have to do is look at me to know that every word is true.
Tell me about your first record.
Well, the first record takes me back to my dim and distant past. My Auntie Gertie, she gave us a wind-up gramophone and a whole batch of 78s, and one of them, which has stuck in my memory, even though I was only 9 when I learnt it, was a thing called Not Old Enough to Be Old, and it's all about the problems a man has when he's 50. Why that should appeal to me when I was 9, I'm not quite sure. But now that I have tragically got past the 50 mark, it cuts me to the quick, but it's a very funny record.
When a man reaches 40, then how time flies, gee whiz. He's 42, 44, 46, 48 before he knows where he is. Then when he reaches 50, he has his jubilee. Though why that's a call for jubilation is a thing that I never could see. For he's not old enough to be old, poor fella, and he's not young enough to be young. He's reached that awkward stage that they call the dangerous age. He's got that well-fed middle age spread, and his body's underslung. And when he tries to Charleston hole, his heart says yes, but his chassis says no. 'Cause he's not old enough to be old, poor fella, and he's not young enough to be young.
Not Old Enough to Be Old, sung by W.H. Berry with the Palace Theatre Orchestra, conducted by Percy Fletcher. Do we know what W.H.'s name is?
I don't. I think he was, he sang under the name W.H. Berry. His friends probably called him W. I mean, he also sang with Henry Hall's orchestra, and he was a very well-known music hall comedian and an actor, and made some films.
But fascinating that you should have been attracted by that. Obviously, you were spotting lyrics as a child. When would you say you were?
I think I was. I always liked pop records with great lyrics, although I didn't realise that was why I liked them. I mean, I loved people like Eddie Cochran's Summertime Blues and all the early Lieber Stoller songs and that one, even pre-rock
what
and roll.
What about Gilbert and Sullivan?
Yes, I was very fond of Gilbert and Sullivan. My headmaster at prep school was a Gilbert and Sullivan fanatic in the nicest possible way, and he used to take us all to see GNS shows. I loved it all.
Mm. And your parents were wordsmiths as well?
Yes, they were both writers. My father edited an aviation magazine with great skill, and my mother was a freelance writer who was quite successful. She wrote lots of short stories, articles for the Times, did broadcasts for the BBC. You know, she was just a clever writer, I think. And we weren't a very musical house, but we were a very literary house.
Take a pair of sparkling eyes, hidden ever and anon, in a merciful eclipse. Do not heed their mild surprise, having passed the Rubicon. Take a pair of rosy lips. Take a figure trimly planned, such as admiration whets. Be particular in this. Take a tender little hand, fringed with dainty fingerettes. Press it, press it. In parenthesis, take all these, you lucky man. Take and keep them if you can, if you can. Take all these, you lucky man. Take and keep them if you can, if you can.
You wrote lists, I gather.
I wrote lots of lists. I used to love lists and charts. And I think that's really got me into both cricket and astronomy and pop music. All these things which are not obviously connected were all linked by statistics and lists. And, of course, the statistics from the world of astronomy, I was very hooked on that in an early age when I read a book that my father left lying around the house on the solar system. And I still remember all the names of the planets and all their satellites. It's rather sad, really, but I can still recite them. The trouble is, Saturn had 9 moons when I was a kid. It's now got about 67. And as far as I'm concerned, it's still got 9.
And I gather that you would sort of write lists of the longest rivers in the world and give it to your mother for her birthday.
Yes, yes, God. Lucky, she allowed me to stay at home, really. But let schoolboys' diaries and all that.
Interesting, of course, shots miscellany today, you know.
I know. Cells if on only this. I'd realised
exactly.
I could have made a...
You were a boy before your time.
Yes.
I mean, is it not true that you, in fact, had an idea for the Guinness Book of Hit Singles, which you took to somebody and they poo-pooed it and said, no, nobody's interested in lists?
Yes, that was true. That was Desmond Elliott, a very distinguished publisher. I took this idea for the Guinness Book of Hit Singles, which would have been a short book in those days because the charts hadn't been going very long. But he didn't like the idea, but he did say, well, what else do you do? And I said, well, I'm trying to be a songwriter. I was actually trying to be a pop singer, but that seemed a bit embarrassing to admit. And I played him a song I'd written, which had been recorded, amazingly. And he didn't like that either. But he said, well, I know a young man called Andrew Lloyd Webber, who I'm sort of looking after. Maybe you should get together with him, because he's another songwriter. And that was how we met.
And you wrote to Andrew, and can I quote this? I understand you're looking for a with it writer.
Yes.
Cringe.
There's not a lot. I mean, the expression with it is about as unwith it as you can get.
I think my mother uses it. Yes.
Well, he responded. He rang me, and I went round to his parents' flat in South Kensington. And he was terrific. I mean, I was barely through the door when he said, oh, I've written 8 musicals, and he'd sat down at the piano and played me tunes that he'd written from these shows he'd done at school. He'd just left school, and I was a struggling law student. And it was clear to me, after about half an hour, that this was a chap who was going to go a very long way, because A, he was very talented, and B, he was very confident.
Record number 2.
Well, record number 2 is David Essex, and I'm a great fan of David's and a great friend of David's. And he made a wonderful record, which wasn't a big hit. It was a sort of small hit, part of a project by Mike Reed. Not the actor, right, Mike Reed, but the disc jockey and television presenter, Mike Reed, who set a lot of John Betjeman's poems to music and got a lot of good singers to sing them. And I just loved David Essex singing Mavanwy.
David Essex singing Mavanwy, written by John Betjeman, music by Mike Reed. David Essex, of course, was the narrator, the Che Guevara figure in Evita. Great voice for rock music with that lovely hoarse thing. Is that kind of pop singer that you would have fancied being had you become one?
I would have liked to have just been a good pop singer. I mean, I would have settled for anything, really. In my dreams, I would like to have been a blues singer, sort of Rolling Stones type.
But you were in a band at school.
We had a band at school called the Aardvarks, who weren't that great, but we weren't bad. And we used to do all the Cliff Richard and Shadows numbers. This is pre-Beatles.
You were Cliff at that point, weren't you?
I was a kind of Cliff, yes. Oh. Travelling Light was one of my big numbers.
Living Doll, I can imagine.
No, I didn't do Living Doll for some reason. Travelling Light, I was quite good at that
this
one.
This was early 60s at Lancing.
Yes.
And you were obviously very bright, but for some reason, academically, you didn't particularly distinguish yourself. Why not?
I just never really quite fulfilled perhaps early expectations when I seemed quite bright when I was very young.
And after all those lists.
Yes. I didn't really want to go to university. I don't know why. I can't remember thinking I don't want to go. I just was rather indolent and didn't really make any strong decision about anything, and kind of felt I wanted to write or do something like that or sing, which in a way half of me thought I wanted to do that. The other half thought this is ludicrous. People, you know, in my situation don't do that, and anyway I'm not quite good enough. So if I had pursued, you know, incredibly enthusiastically the path of being a pop singer as soon as I left school, I mean, I might have made a record or two, who knows.
But you did make one, didn't you?
Well, yes, but that was only as a result, really, of having some success as a writer. I mean, I had a song recorded by a group. I was trying to sell my own voice. And ironically, it was the songs people liked, not me.
So fate was pushing you towards being a lyricist, but you didn't spot it at the time.
Well, I was writing the tunes as well at that stage, amazingly. I mean, they weren't very sophisticated tunes, but actually, when I met Andrew, I'd actually had a tune out and recorded. It was a flop, but I'd actually had a record released.
Was he impressed?
No. Well, he might have
been. Not with
the
tune.
No. He said it was a nick of something, which was very annoying. He's probably right. It was only three chords.
But he was writing, I think, the life of a musical based on the life of Dr.
Yes.
Bernard at the time, which was surely a nick of Oliver.
Well, he'd written a musical with a school friend based on the life of Dr. Bernardo. And I wrote a kind of Lionel Bart-ish Richard Rodgers, or rather Oscar Hammerstein-ish type lyric to it. And they were okay. And some of them worked, particularly the funny ones. But I realised after a couple of years that the whole project was not really original enough. We both realised this. And it was the next thing we did together, which was really a bit of a come down. We had these dreams of the West End and Broadway, and we actually even signed a contract for our Bernardo musical, which promised us first-class airfares to New York when we opened. I mean, we would have been grateful for the tube fare. When that clearly wasn't going to work, we then wrote something for a school, which was a big come-down and not what we wanted to do. But we then broke all the rules and found our own style. And the thing we wrote for a school was Joseph, which gradually made it.
Bye.
record number three?
Well, this is Once in Royal David's City, sung by the King's College Choir. It's just a magnificent hymn. It takes me back to my school days, to my youth, to my children. I've got a young daughter now and children aged, you know, 5 to 10. It's almost a perfect age as a father, I think.
Once in Royal David's City with the choir of King's College, Cambridge, conducted by Sir David Wilcox. So, Joseph happened, 1968. You wrote it for Collett Court Boys' Prep School in Hammersmith, and it was revolutionary, wasn't it? It took off. I mean, there you have a biblical story with kind of country and western rock hoedowns in it.
Well, it was very popular. It was immediately done again by the school. I mean, literally, it was a 20-minute show, and we had to do the whole show again. Most parents want to get out of the door pretty quickly, having seen their darling do their bit. And we did it again, and then it gradually made it to other schools. It took a long time to get going.
And then eventually it was different.
It was different because we didn't think we were writing a show. Therefore, we didn't obey the rules that we thought the rules had to be obeyed. We weren't trying to do what Richard Rodgers would have done. We were just trying to do something that was fun for children. And the success we had in a very minor way, educationally almost, with Joseph, inspired us to go back to the Bible for something a bit more ambitious, which was the story of the last 7 days of the life of Jesus. And Superstar, which is what that became, turned out to be such a huge commercial success that in turn kicked Joseph into the commercial area. Mm. Because Joseph was only a hit with schools until about 1970, 71. And then Frank Dunlop did a brilliant production, almost without asking us, at the Edinburgh Festival in 1972, which got rave reviews, better reviews than Superstar got. Consequently, we suddenly found we had two shows on our hands that were hits at the same time.
You were off. But the point about Superstar, it was completely different. It was revolutionary. I know there'd been Hair before, so there'd been a rock musical, but it was through sung, wasn't it?
Yes, it was different. I mean, like it or loathe it, it was certainly new. And the reason really was that we couldn't sell it as a show. We had a very good agent manager at that time, David Land, and he was trying to get all the big impresarios of the day, the Cameron McIntoshes of the day, to put on Superstar. And nobody wanted to know. Oh, religion's had it. The kids and the public don't want that, and it's too rocky or whatever.
And hugely expensive.
And very expensive. And we were unknown, and Joseph hadn't really made any money for us at that point. So we were kind of forced, almost reluctantly, to do it on record, which turned out to be a brilliant move. And it was shorter. We couldn't make it too long. We had to make it much more radio-friendly, much more rocky, much more contemporary. And we made it truly operatic. And all these things conspired to make Superstar different from things that had gone before.
And that whole idea of putting out the music before you put on the show was born, which turned out to be a terrific idea.
Yes, we were hailed as marketing geniuses. We were actually desperate guys who couldn't get a show on.
The 60s turned into the 70s anyway. Rice and Lloyd Webber were riding high towards their very last production together. Let's pause for record number four.
We've got the Everly Brothers doing a unique take on the great Dean Martin song.
Take one fresh and tender kiss. Stolen night of bliss. One girl, one boy, some grief, some joy. Memories are made of this. Don't forget a small.
Everly Brothers' version of Memories Are Made of This. So you move towards your third and final collaboration, Tim Rice, which was to be Evita. A strange subject, an unusual subject. How much persuasion did it take to get Andrew to go along with Eva Peron as the subject of a musical?
Well, I think he was always intrigued by it, but I don't think he was that confident about it as a subject. I heard this program on the radio about Eva Peron, about whom I knew very little. And I then spent about a year working out how it could be done, because the character immediately intrigued me. And I thought, this is a great melodramatic subject which will suit our style.
But my point in asking the question is, really, I get the distinct impression you were the ideas man in that sense.
In the sense that I came up with that particular idea. But
and superstar, and Jesus,
yes,
really were yours.
In a way, but I wouldn't have come up with them if I hadn't had a reason to come up with them, if you see what
no.
I mean.
But was Andrew already moving more towards the business end as well as the music?
I think he was always more interested in the business end than I was. I think he was a bit reluctant to totally commit to Evita in the first instance. But once he saw what a great story it was, and once he'd written a couple of tunes, and I said, these tunes are fantastic, and I think it, in many ways, it's, perhaps I'm biased because I was involved, but I still think it's his best score.
Do you think it's your best?
I think it's the best show we did together.
However, there you are with the best thing you've done together, and then you part. Now, people I know have asked you a million times. Hesitate before asking you again, but it must mean you've never given a satisfactory answer.
Well, there isn't a satisfactory answer. We kind of drifted apart. I mean, we were. Firstly, I didn't have another idea that really appealed to me that quickly. Andrew wanted to do some things on his own. He did a very successful album, Variations on a Theme of Paganini. And then he got this idea for Cats, which I thought, like he wasn't that wild about Evita to begin with, I thought this is clearly a bad idea. And apart from that, it didn't need a lyricist because the poems were there already. So,
but there was, let me just interrupt you one second, there was a song cycle called Tell Me on a Sunday, which he did then with Don Black and Marty Webb.
Yes, I don't know how that came about. I mean, that was very successful and indeed very good.
Yes, but people say that your fingerprints were on that.
Oh, I don't think so, no. I mean, we discussed the possibility of doing something along those lines, and I did write one lyric, but it never got anywhere. I don't know, I guess perhaps I wasn't enthusiastic enough about it.
To feature Elaine Page.
Yes, well, I don't know what it was. I mean, maybe Andrew didn't want to work at that point with me and Elaine. I don't know. But, I mean, it never happened. But to be fair, we never really got beyond doing a couple of songs. And suddenly I heard he was doing something with Marty Webb and Don Black, and it was hugely successful.
But were you a bit miffed?
Oh, of course. Absolutely. But, I mean, I was miffed in one sense, but I was miffed rather like dog in the manger. I didn't really want to do it, but I was annoyed that he was doing it with somebody else. But Don is a good friend of mine, and he's a brilliant lyricist. So, the work was a great success.
Of course. But you know what the theory is, though, that Andrew was very driven and that you were sort of too laid back for your own good.
There's an element of truth in that, but I had to be enthusiastic about the subject, and I think Andrew is one of these people. I mean, he's a very talented, extraordinarily talented composer for the theatre, and I think he only functions if he's got something that he's doing, and he'd rather do anything than nothing. This is probably very unfair.
You'd rather do nothing than anything. Is this where we're going with this?
I'd rather do nothing than something I don't want to do.
But essentially, you and Andrew drifted apart.
It was a drift. It wasn't a major.
There was no
coming
bust,
to blows.
Major
there was no
bust
fight.
Up.
No. So, yeah, that's it.
Record number five.
Record number five is Elvis. I have to have Elvis. If you know about Elvis, you'll know why I have to have him. If you don't, you'll never understand. And this is an early Elvis. I could have taken one of about 90 Elvis tracks, literally. And this is an early one, 1955. I'm Left, You're Right, She's Gone.
We're right, I'm left, she's gone. Right, and I'm left all alone. Well, you tried to tell me so, but how was I to know? Like she was not the one for me. You told me all alone. You're right, our love was wrong. But now I've changed my mind, cause she broke the tie. And I know that she'd never care for me. Well, I thought I knew just what she'd do. I guess I'm not so smart. Or you trying to tell me all alone? She'd only break my heart. I'm left, you're right, she's gone. You're right, and I'm left all alone. Well, she's gone, I know not where. But now, I just don't care. For now, I'm falling for you. I'll make it up somehow. So happy we will be in a home for me. And I'll soon forget now I know. Well, I thought I knew just what she'd do. I guess I'm not so smart. Why you try to tell me all alone? You don't break my heart. I'm left, she's gone. You're right, and I'm left all alone. Well, she's gone, I know not who.
I just don't care. On the behalf of falling for you.
Elvis with I'm Left, You're Right, She's Gone, or You're Right, I'm Left, She's Gone, which is what he sings, isn't it?
Yes, he seems a bit confused about which way round the title should
be. Well, it works both ways. Yes. Good lyric, what?
Brilliant lyric, great lyric.
1955, he recorded that. So, Andrew Lloyd Webber went on riding high through the 80s with Cat, Starlight, Phantom later on, and Sunset Boulevard, while you floundered slightly.
Oh, absolutely. I wasn't quite sure. I mean, I did have a good idea, which came too late to get Andrew involved, because he was already into Cats and I think Phantom. And actually, Andrew asked me to get involved with Phantom at one point, but it was like only do five songs, and I think I was the 19th person he'd asked, so I passed on that. And anyway, by then I was already working on something with Bjorn and Benny from ABBA, which was an idea I had called Chess, which was about a love story set in the time of the Cold War, America versus Russia on the chessboard. was kind of saved by getting involved with the great Walt Disney Organization.
But there were quite a few years between the two. I mean, there were sort of wilderness years, if you like.
Well,
you've talked yourself about coming back from the dead when Disney kind of you had a contract.
I mean, looking back on the
90s.
Dates, I mean, Chess opened and closed very rapidly on Broadway in 1988, and I was working with Disney by 1990, so if anything, it was only 1989 I wasn't doing a lot.
Oh, yes.
And actually, even then I was doing something. I translated a wonderful French musical called Starmania. It didn't do a thing over here. And we never got the show over here. But there were some great songs in it, and that kept me off the streets in 1989.
Sure, but Disney put your name back there. Aladdin, Beauty and
yes,
the Beast,
I've
and
always
then
loved the cinema.
The Lion King.
Really, the cinema, I grew up with the cinema much more than theatre. I never went to theatre as a child. They had this new project called King of the Jungle. It was all about a lion. It was like Hamlet with fur. It was, you know, evil uncle and father and son relationship, and it sounded great to me, and I said, yes, I'd love to do that. And they said, who would you like to write the music? And I said, well, Elton John, thinking, you won't get him. And they said, we'll get him. And they got him.
And can you feel the love tonight? It is where it's enough for this wide-eyed wanderer that we've got this far. And can you feel the love tonight? How it's late. All in turn, there's a rhyme and reason to the wild outdoors. When the heart of the star-crossed voyager beats in time with yours. It is where we are. It's enough for this wide-eyed wanderer that we got this far. Enough to make kings and vagabonds believe the very best.
Record number six.
Well, this is actually, I feel a bit embarrassed about this, but I've decided to give in and take a song I was involved with. And it's sung by Elaine, and it's from Chess. And it's just, I think, almost my favourite song of all the songs I've ever written. Certainly the favourite love song I've written, and it's called Heaven Help My Heart.
Thank you. if it were love, I would give that love every second I have. And I do. Did I know where he'd lead me to? Did I plan doing all of this for the love of a man? Well, I let it happen anyhow. And what I'm feeling now has no easy explanation. Reason plays no part. Heaven help my heart. So my whole existence turning around a wordless smile, a touch. One of these days, and it won't be long, he'll know more about me than he should. All my dreams will be understood. No surprise, nothing more to learn from the look in my eyes. Don't you know the time is not my friend? I'll fight it to the end, hoping to keep that best of moments when the passions start. Heaven help my heart. The day that I find suddenly I've run out of secrets, suddenly love a stranger. Well, that's what I've done. Heaven help my heart. Heaven help my heart.
It's public knowledge, obviously, Tim, that you spent 11 years with Elaine Page. You left your wife Jane for her, but in the end you didn't stay with her and so on. I mean, you must have made a lot of people miserable, including yourself.
Oh, absolutely. Total disaster. I mean, it could not have gone wronger, really. But, you know, that's it. I mean, I never agreed with the guy who wrote Je ne regrette rien. That is a really wrong lyric.
One can't help, I mean, forgive me if I quote your own lyrics to you, if I quote from I Know Him So Well, you know, nothing is so good it lasts eternally, perfect situations must go wrong. I mean,
well, that is a lyric which I'm afraid I believe in. But I wasn't wishing that, it's just an observation.
It goes on, of course, he needs his fantasy and freedom, I know him so well.
Well, that's one of the points of view expressed in that song. The other one says he needs security. So it's a complicated song. I don't know whether that many people really analyse that song. I mean, some people do.
It is interesting, though, this business of writing from the heart. I mean, I think it's been observed before that Andrew Lloyd Webber wrote Phantom.
Yes,
because of Sarah Brightman.
I think Phantom is a great work because Andrew wrote it from the heart. He was written for the right reason, for Sarah Brightman.
So you'll sit on your desert island and play Heaven Help My Heart and sort of...
And a bit of Elvis as well.
pick over how it might have been or should have been, or do you take
no,
the blame?
No, I'll try not to do that. No, I will go jogging up and down the beach.
You're not going to take any blame for everything that's happened to the women in your life?
Of course, absolutely. But not all of it.
Rien, ni le bien.
Record number seven.
Right, record number seven is the Rolling Stones, or are the Rolling Stones. And I just, you know, think the Rolling Stones are brilliant. I think they should all be knighted, not just Mick Jagger.
Rolling Stones with The Last Time. There was a time a few years ago, Tim, when you had four shows, I think, running on Broadway, of which you were the official lyricist. Are you still got how many?
Are there three still, as we speak?
But Lion King has scooped the pool, really.
Lion King is the one that's going to be there for a long time.
So now you can choose what you do. You know, now you're absolutely
up there again.
What are you choosing to do?
Well, I'm working on a couple of new things. I know everybody would say that, but I've got what I think is a good idea, and I'm drafting out the story. And
so it's a show?
Oh, yes, I think it's a show. I mean, I suppose it could be something that one might say, well, maybe it should be a film. We've also had a serious film offer for Chess, which would be great, because I think maybe that might be the way to go with Chess, rather than keep trying to get it right on stage and not quite getting it right. Maybe it might, you know, be infinitely better as a movie.
What about doing a straight play?
I'd like to give it a go sometime. I'm not sure if I could, but people always say the great thing about musical theatre, whenever you interview a musical theatre person, they say the great thing about musical theatre is the collaboration. This, for me, is the worst. It's the one thing I hate about it. You know, it's you have to worry about the other people. I mean, obviously, if it all works out, it's great, but I think, wouldn't it be wonderful if I could do everything in a musical and didn't have to collaborate? And at least with a play, to a certain extent, you wouldn't have to worry about getting it right for the other writer.
What about the health of the British musical today? I mean, what have we got? We've got We Will Rock You, we've got Bombay Dreams. Got a view?
Well, I don't think... I mean, what's strange is there never been any consistently successful, or even intermittently, that for that matter, new British writers come up for ages. It's a bit worrying. I mean, brand new musicals, they're terribly difficult to do, and even us old hands find it hard enough. And I just don't think people are really trying, and they try and imitate Sondheim, or they try and imitate the style that has already been done brilliantly by somebody else.
Mm. Would there be better stuff around if you and Lloyd Webber had stuck together?
Well, I don't know. There certainly wouldn't have been any more successful stuff. I mean, you couldn't have had a bigger show than Phantom, or for that matter, The Lion King, really.
But do you sometimes wish you had stuck together?
I certainly think often it would have been nice if we'd done a few more together. On the other hand, it was a tough act to follow, and if we'd had a couple of flops together, then that might have taken some of the luster away from the old ones. People would have said, well, we knew they weren't any good, the early ones were flukes. And I think the fact we've both done okay with other people proves that maybe they weren't flukes.
Last record.
The last one is a sentimental choice. It's a record about a father and his daughter, and it's one of my favourite American pop singers, Bobby Darin. It's called 18 Yellow Roses, and it just reminds me of being a father.
Eighteen yellow roses came today. Eighteen yellow roses in a pretty bouquet. When the boy came to the door, I didn't know what to say. But 18 yellow roses came today. I opened up the card to see what it said. I couldn't believe my eyes when I had read. Though you belong to another, I love you anyway. Yes, 18 yellow roses came today. I never doubted your love for a minute. I always thought that you would be true. But now this box and the flowers in it, I guess there's nothing left for me to do but ask to meet the boy that's done this thing. And find out if he's got plans to buy you a ring. 'Cause 18 yellow roses will wilt and die one day. But a father's love will never fade away. Will never fade away.
Bobby Darin with 18 Yellow Roses. I know how you sweated over this list, and I hate to ask you to choose but one, but you must.
Well, I think I'd probably go for Once in Royal David City.
Would you?
I don't know. It's just, you know, so emotional.
What about your book as well as the Bible and Shakespeare?
Well, my book is The Complete Molesworth by Geoffrey Willans, who wrote the words, and Ronald Searle, who did the marvellous cartoons, which is Nigel Molesworth, famous savant and philosopher, schoolboy, and his take on life as seen through the terms of a prep school. It's just a brilliant book and very funny, and I would enjoy reading that.
And your luxury?
I think I take a telescope because I could look at the stars and try and teach myself something more about them, and also look for ships on the horizon.
And a kiss, add one stolen night of bliss, one girl, one boy, some grief, some joy, memories are made of this, don't forget a small moonbeam. Fold in lightly with a dream. The memories you gave me. Your lips and mine, two sips of wine. Memories are made of this.
Then add the wedding bells, the one house where lovers dwell, three little kids for the flavor. Stir carefully through the days, see how the flavor stays. These are the dreams you will savor.
With his blessings from above,
you can't beat the memories you gave me.
Serve it generously with love.
You can't beat the memories you gave me.
One man, one wife, one love through life. Memories are made of this.
You can't beat the memories you gave me.
Memories are made of this.
Sir Tim Rice, thank you very much indeed for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Thank you.